let him eat it with his bread. And let that be an end to it. Let him sit in. Let him sit in his punishment.
Destiny guides our fortunes more favorably than we could have expected. Look there, Sancho Panza, my friend, and see those 30 or so wild giants with whom I intend to do battle and kill each and all of them, so that their stolen booty we can begin to enrich ourselves. This is noble, righteous warfare, for it is wonderfully useful to God to have such an evil race wiped from the face of the earth. can see over there, answered his master, with the huge arms, some of which are very nearly 2 leagues long. Now look, your grace. What you see over there on giants but windmills. And what seems to be arms are just their sails that go around in the wind and turn the millstone. Obviously. You don't know much about adventure.
Thank you.
which our first parents called the Age of Gold. Not because of the gold, so much adored in this age, was then easily purchased, but because those two fatal words, mine and thine, were distinctions unknown to the people of those fortunate times. For all things were in common in that holy age. Men, for their sustenance, needed only lift their hands and take it from the sturdy oak, whose spreading arms liberally invited them to gather the wholesome and savory fruit. While the clear springs and silver rivulets, with luxuriant plenty, ordered them their pure, refreshing water. In hollow trees and in the clefts of rocks, the laboring and industrious bees erected their little commonwealths that might reap with pleasure and with ease the sweet and fertile harvest of their toils. The tough and strenuous cork trees did of themselves and without other art than their native liberality dismiss and impart their broad light bark, which served to cover these lonely huts, propped up with rough-hewn stakes, that were first built as shelter against the inclemencies of air. Up with rough-hewn stakes. They were first built as a shelter against the inclements of air. All then was union, all peace, all love and friendship in the world, yet no rude plowshare with violence to pry into the pious bowels of our Mother Earth, for she, without compulsion, kindly yielded from every part of her fruitful and spacious bosom, whatever it might at once satisfy, sustain, and indulge her frugal children. Then was when innocent, beautiful young shepherdesses went tripping over the hills and vales, their lovely hair sometimes plaited, sometimes loose and flowing, clad in the woven vessel, decently, what modesty you would have always concealed. Tyrian dye and the rich glossy hue of silk, martyred and dissembled into every color, which are now esteemed so fine and magnificent, were unknown to the innocent plainness of that age. Arrayed in the most magnificent garments, and all the most sumptuous adornments which idleness and luxury had taught succeeding pride. Lovers then expressed the passion of their souls in the unaffected language of the heart, with the native plainness and sincerity in which they were conceived, and divested of all that artificial contexture which enervates what labors to enforce, imposture, deceit, and malice had not yet crept in and imposed themselves unbridled upon mankind in the disguise of truth and simplicity. Justice, unbiased either by favor or interest, which now so fatally perverted, was equally impartial. Nor was it the judge's fancy. There were neither judges nor causes to be judged. The modest maid might walk wherever she pleased alone, free from the attacks of the lewd, assiduous importuners. But in this degenerate age, fraud and a legion of ills infecting the world, no virtue can be safe, no honor can be secure. While wanton desires diffused into the hearts of men corrupt the strictest watches and those closest retreats, which, though as intricate and unknown as the labyrinth of Crete, are no security for the chastity. Thus that primitive innocence being vanished, the oppression daily prevailing, there was a necessity to oppose the torrent of violence, for which reason the order of the knighthood errant was instituted to defend the honor of virgins, protect widows, relieve orphans, and assist the distressed in general. Now I myself am one of this order. And though all people are obliged by law of nature to be kind to persons in trouble, yet since you, without knowing anything of this obligation, have so generously entertained me, I ought to pay you my utmost acknowledgement, and accordingly return you my most hearty thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. Oh, how our good knight reveled in this speech, and more than ever when he came to think of the name that he should give his lady. As the story goes, there was a very good-looking farm girl who lived nearby, with whom he had once been smitten, although it is generally believed that she never knew or suspected it. Her name was Aldonza Lorenzo, and it seemed to him that she was the one upon whom he should bestow the title of Mistress of His Thoughts. For her, he wished a name that should not be incongruous with his own, and that would convey the suggestion of a princess or a great lady. And accordingly, he resolved to call her Dulciana del Cavalcio, she being a native of that place. A musical name to his ears, out of the ordinary and significant, like the others he had chosen for himself and his accoutrements.
Thank you.
destiny guides our fortunes more favorably than we could have expected. Look there, Sancho Panza, my friend, and see those 30 or so wild giants with whom I intend to do battle, and kill each and all of them. So with their stolen booty, we can begin to enrich ourselves. This is noble, righteous warfare, for it is wonderfully useful to God to have such an evil race wiped from the face of the earth. What giants, asked Sancho Panza. The ones you can see over there, with the huge gnarls. So some of them, which are very nearly 2 leagues long. Now look, your grace, said Sancho. But you see, over there are arch-giants, but windmills, and what seems to be arms are just their sails that go around in the wind and turn the mills to obviously, replied Don Quixote, you don't know much about windmills.
let his sin be his punishment. Let him eat it with his head, and let that be an end to it.